because I feel we've broken the ice slightly in the morning and know each other better now, I'm hoping that this session, which we have a great deal of time for, we'll see how wonderful, I think, rather than have unbroken monologue from me, which I know can get very tiring and sleep-inducing, especially at this time of the day when everyone's quite tired already, I imagine. I'd just like to really build on what Father Melchizedek said in his wonderful talk this morning about the Mother of God being a person who is still with us, the mother of us all, a loving person to whom we relate in the church and who cares for us and who spreads her veil over all people throughout the world. This is so important to remember. She is a living person. She is still with us. And in this talk, I'm going to be going through some, and I want to look at some of the other types that we use to describe the Mother of God, or we even address her as epithets using these types. In the Akathistos hymn, for example, we say, "Rejoice, you who are the burning bush, the ladder of Jacob," and so on. And to ask the question, why do we call her these names? Why do we refer to these types? What is their meaning? And how do they draw us closer to the Mother of God as we seek to understand them and reflect on them? The second half of the talk, I'm going to turn to just looking at some icons with you. Some are simply of the Mother of God with the Christ child, and there are some wonderful examples in this church which we could look at as well. Obviously, the real things are better than photographs. But I will be using this PowerPoint presentation. That's what I've structured my talk around. But if you want to look at the other icons and bring them into the discussion, that would be wonderful, especially the wonderful icon of the Mother of God of Pantanissa. So the second half will be to do with iconography. The first half will be to do with typology. But I want you to try to hold together some ideas in your minds as we go along, and perhaps we can try to pull together the threads at the very end and think, how do all these images, whether they're types or icons, relate to the Mother of God as a person, as our Panagia, as the Mother of God who is so close to us, who cares for us, and who even saves us when we pray to her? I think I'll just add one more remark as a sort of preface to what I'm going to be saying, which is I think that the Orthodox tradition succeeds in an almost miraculous way, it seems to me, in holding together her huge holiness, her sanctity, her relation to the divine, her immensity when we call her wider than heaven, because she held God the Logos in her womb, and she was that holy space in which God made his appearance in creation. But we also, the Orthodox tradition, remembers her always and never undermines her humanity, that she is one of us. Perhaps in some traditions, I don't like to criticize other churches, but for example, in the Roman Catholic Church, there is sometimes slight tendency to exalt her and to forget her humanity. I think that happens to some extent. It's a danger of establishing dogmas such as the Immaculate Conception. It somehow removes her from humanity and makes her separate from us. But Orthodox tradition has always adhered to the view that she is human, truly human, but also truly all holy, and chosen by God from the very beginning of creation to bear his Son and to bring him into this creation. So to begin with typology, and I'm going to try to stay coordinated with this PowerPoint presentation. presentation that I've put together. Just to remind you from yesterday, or if you weren't present yesterday, what typology is. It is a form of imagery in a way. St. John of Damascus called typology a way of, a kind of an image of divine truth. But it is these foreshadowings, prefigurations, or signs, if you like, which are in the Old Testament, revealed to us through the word of the Old Testament, which appears in human beings, in people, in objects or events, which, as the fathers later could see as they reflected and meditated on this text, were revealing the role of the Mother of God in the new dispensation. So they are signs, and they are mysterious in this way, that they are not explicit, and they don't immediately spring to mind as revealing the Mother of God. And that's what the church helps us to do in hymnography, is to understand these signs, and as we read the Old Testament text, to see here we are being told about the Mother of God and about the Incarnation, because it's always connected with her role in the Incarnation. So I've put up a list of a few of the most classic types that are used by the church as images of the Mother of God. We are reminded of these, especially in the feasts of the church, in the hymnography for these feasts. And they include, for example, Jacob's ladder, which is, of course, a story in Genesis, which I'll come to in a moment, because I'm going to look at these in more detail. The burning bush, the dew or the rain on Gideon's fleece. We often find references to the Mother of God as queen, princess, daughter of the king. This is a reference especially to the Psalms, Psalm 44 in particular, in which we are told of a daughter of the king or a princess, and the church fathers later saw this as revealing the role that the Mother of God would play. And it's also referring, I think, to her role as the bride of Christ, and that's again seen in the Song of Songs. And another one, which is particularly mysterious, I think, and which has many reference points, many types in the Old Testament, is that of the mountain. We see mountains all over the place in Scripture, of course. They often refer to a high, holy place where God reveals himself. We think immediately of Sinai, for example, or Mount Tabor, where the Transfiguration took place. Epiphanies often occur on mountains, and the imagery is obvious. A mountain reaches up to heaven. But why would it refer to the Mother of God? Why would we see the mountain being named with a specific reference to Mary, the Mother of God? So I've chosen just four of these to look at in detail, and I'm going to talk about them, read the texts, and then I hope you will give me your ideas as we go along so that we can have this be slightly a discussion as well as a lecture. Let's begin with Jacob's ladder. I've put up a text from a canon to illustrate this type as it's understood in the church. And I've also put up an illustration. I'm sorry it's in black and white, because in fact, this is a manuscript illustration in vivid color, a 12th century manuscript, which contains homilies by a preacher called James of Kokinovafos. He had a whole collection of sermons, homilies, for feasts of the Mother of God, which were illustrated. And it's one of the few places where we see these types that refer to the Mother of God, which he uses in his sermon, being illustrated. So you see on the right, Jacob's ladder, and this is a specific reference to the Mother of God. So Jacob's ladder, what is this story and why does it refer to the Mother of God? It's in Genesis, of course. If we look at the text, Genesis 28, verse 10 and following, I'd just like to read out and remind you of the biblical text. This is the story of Jacob going out towards Haran. He's traveling, in other words, away from his homeland towards Mesopotamia, I think. He came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. Then he took one of the stones of that place and put it at his head, and he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to heaven. And there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. You can see in the image, that's what's depicted. So behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. Do not fear. The land on which you lie, I will give you to you and your seed. Also your seed shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and the east, to the north and the south. And in you and your seed, all the tribes of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. So this is a story really of an appearance of God to Jacob, a kind of a new covenant with him. But it's also a story about heaven and earth being joined together by this ladder of the divine realm and the created realm being shown to have a connection with angels going between them. Why should this be associated with the Mother of God? We see in the hymn that I've quoted here, a canon written by John the Monk in the 8th century probably, the Holy Scriptures speak of you mystically, O Mother of the Most High. For Jacob saw in days of old the ladder that prefigured you and said, this is the stair on which God shall tread. This image of Mary, the Mother of God, being the ladder indicates her role as the way in which God enters creation and the way in which humanity and creation can meet God through her, the ladder. It's interesting that the fathers, before this type came to light, and it's the case that with most of these Marian types, it took some centuries for Christian thinkers to begin to associate these types with Mary, the Mother of God. Earlier fathers talked about this ladder. They saw it both important as a historical event being described in the Old Testament. This is part of the narrative of the salvation story of the Old Testament and of Jacob and his life and so forth. But they also did interpret it allegorically before they came to this typology of the Mother of God. So we see in some early texts it being seen as a kind of allegorical expression of how the human soul ascends to God through asceticism, through prayer. There are other ways we can interpret the ladder, and I think it's never necessary to abandon any of these interpretations. It can mean all of these things at once. It can have the historical meaning, it can have a sort of moral meaning. We think of the heavenly ladder of John Climacos, for example, is a perfect example of ascetic ideas of the ladder being the ascetic ascent towards contemplation of God. But it can also hold this meaning of actually physically representing the Mother of God and her place in creation as this person whose feet are on the ground, as St. John of Damascus pictured it in one of his homilies, and whose head reaches to heaven. She literally joins heaven and earth in her person. I'd just like to stop there and ask if you have any comments on this type, anything to add to what I've already said, or reflections. When you think when you hear of this type in the services or when you look at images of it? Fotini.
Yes. Not necessarily talking about typology, but somehow that phrase, "This is the stair on which God shall tread," just absolutely knocks my heart out, because somehow we get inured, so accustomed to things, that when it's recast somehow, and this in particular, God treading, you know, it just seems so daring. And it reminds me of my very first year, if I may be anecdotal for a moment, the first time I experienced Lent as Orthodox, and in the Lenten Triodion, shortly before Pascha, the phrase, someone will know it better than I, when Mary wiped with her hair the feet which Eve heard walking in the garden. And I nearly fell to the ground when I heard that phrase, this somersault of just the immediacy that it brings. The shock of that never leaves me. And this suddenly has reminded me. I just don't know if that's useful, but I just wanted to share that sense of shock.
Yes, it is very shocking. It's
but glorious shock.
Very glorious, but it reminds us, as so many passages in the Old Testament do, of God's imminence. He is present, and he manifests himself.
Holy ground.
Yes. Any other thoughts or... See, that's my last slide on the Jacob's ladder, but we'll move on, if not, and look at the burning bush. Now, the burning bush is another very mysterious sign. Of course, I'm sure you all know the story in Exodus. But again, because these passages are fairly short, I feel I can read them out. I hope that's all right to remind ourselves. Before we look at the later development, the hymnography, and the images. This is, of course, the story of Moses when he first is called by God to go and save the Jews and to bring them out of Egypt. So it's a very important moment in the story of Joseph. He was tending the sheep of Jethro, his father-in-law, and he led them to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God, so another mountain. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he saw the bush burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. So Moses said, "I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not consumed." When therefore the Lord saw him turn aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, "Moses, Moses." Then he said, "Here I am." So he said, "Do not come any closer. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground." Moreover, he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." Moses then hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. So it's a miraculous event. Moses clearly knows immediately this is miraculous. The bush is burning, but it's not being consumed. Nothing is happening to the bush, it remains intact. And then the Lord speaks to him from the bush, from the middle of the bush. Now again, with this type, with this sign, various early Christian fathers began to interpret it in an allegorical way. And when we think of them interpreting it allegorically, again, I want to just emphasize that the fathers never put aside the literal meaning. They believed this really happened. It was an important event in the life of Moses, which led to all those events in Egypt and the crossing of the Red Sea and all the rest of it. But they also saw a deeper, more spiritual meaning in the text. And what some of the earliest fathers, I think Irenaeus of Lyon was one of the earliest fathers to comment on this text, they saw things like the presence of the Holy Spirit in this event, They stress the fact that this is a revelation of God's immanence in creation and how he manifests himself. But it's Gregory of Nyssa in the 4th century who appears, was generally accepted to be the first Greek father, at least, who associated this sign with the Mother of God. And he does this in his Life of Moses. It's a very interesting text which undertakes both a literal and a spiritual or allegorical interpretation of Exodus and of Moses' ascent of Mount Sinai in particular. But in one passage, St. Gregory of Nyssa very explicitly says, this is a sign which reveals the Mother of God. He develops that. He says, the bush represents Mary, the Mother of God. The bush is a material organism, if you like, not an object exactly, a growing plant. This represents her humanity, her true physical nature. The fire is the divinity that came into her, which took up residence in her. God was in this bush, who is Mary, the Mother of God, but it did not consume her. And that is a mysterious mystical sign of her virginity, that she did not lose her virginity in conceiving and bearing, giving birth to Christ, who is God. So he is the originator of this type. I think Father Ephrem suggests, and I'm not sure of this because I haven't checked it, that Saint Ephrem the Syrian may have used that association 20 years earlier or something. So Gregory of Nyssa may not have been the earliest to see it, but he was certainly the one who brought it into the Greek patristic tradition. And it is taken up by all the preachers and hymnographers who were writing about the Mother of God in later centuries. The sign of the burning bush is one of the most common that we see, and we associate it above all now with the Mother of God. Here in our text, which I'll read out now, this is again a canon for the Annunciation by John the Monk. Just one example of many, and I should stress, if you read your Festal Minaeon, you'll find this scattered throughout many feasts. But here is just one example. He writes, the bush that burnt with fire and yet remained unconsumed, disclosed the secret mystery that shall come to pass in you, O pure maiden full of grace. For after childbirth, you will remain ever virgin. And if you can see it in this manuscript illustration, the artist has actually depicted the burning bush with the face of Christ in the middle of it to convey the sense that this is Christ himself in the burning bush. And we as the viewers are supposed to understand this illustration is associated with a homily, I think on the Annunciation, that this is representing the Mother of God. One other nice point in connection with the burning bush, which I think Father Ephrem makes in an article that he wrote about typology. I've given you a reference on the bibliography that I gave you in your handouts. He suggests that we should think of this bush not just as an ordinary bush, but a very thorny bush, a bramble bush, that some of the texts that are written about the Mother of God stress this thorniness just to emphasize her true humanity. She is truly a bush of this world, if you like, which is at the same time burning with this divine fire and bringing forth God. If you like, this is also a type which conveys the container kind of imagery that so many types do. She is a holy space in which God appears. Oh, I actually have what Gregory of Nyssa says about the burning bush in the Life of Moses. As I said earlier, he was one of the first to develop this type. he says, from this we learn also the mystery of the Virgin, the light of divinity, which through birth shone from her into human life, did not consume the burning bush, even as the flower of her virginity was not withered by giving birth. So above all, I think this type is connected with the virginity of the Mother of God and her purity. And this sign in the Old Testament revealing how important that is theologically.
I was thinking about fire and the use of fire for sacrifice in the Old Testament. And obviously Moses was before the building of the temple, so they would just burn sacrifices in outdoors in high places, I suppose. But
yes.
I'm not sure whether there's elements of sacrifice in that and whether that's developed in the Fathers. I don't know whether her humility and her acceptance is considered a sacrifice in that sort of Old Testament sacrificial burning sacrifice sense. I don't know.
I will have to look for that. I'm not sure, to be honest, off the top of my head. There's certainly mention in association with the temple. The idea of her being the sacrifice as well as the temple is often brought out in the liturgical texts. So, in association with the temple and the sacrifice and the atonement that that brings and the offering up to God of this sacrifice, she can feature as the sacrifice. The heifer is often the type that's used for that, which is again from Genesis in association with Abraham, that she is the three-year-old heifer who is brought to the temple. And it's extraordinary with this imagery how it can kind of intermesh, and you can have her being more than one thing at the same time in the same hymn. That always strikes me very much. But I can't say I've seen it in association with the burning bush. The only other thing I would say is that fire is a kind of purifying process throughout Christian history, actually. I was rather shocked. I was having to teach the Reformation, and I was struck by what one historian said about the burning of martyrs, that this particular way of martyring people was chosen because there was a real belief that through the process of burning, they would be purified. Somehow cleansed of their heresy. And in fact, even more shockingly, the more painful the death, and you're probably aware that in history, sometimes people have been subjected to horrifying forms of death. There was a real belief that the more painful, the more likely that person might be actually to be redeemed. It's a hard thought for us to get our heads around, I think, in the 21st century. But fire is certainly a purifying agent, like water.
One second.
Oh, sorry.
I was just going to say, you said that with this one, it kind of emphasizes the virginity and how she was an ever, forever virgin.
Yes.
And we believe as Orthodox, if I'm right, that she remained a virgin, yeah?
Yes.
Now, that thought is Christian. I was just going to ask, why is it so important that we maintain this?
You're right that different churches take very different views on this. Some of the Protestant churches, for example, I have a Lutheran colleague I've talked to this about, can accept the virgin conception, but nothing after that, which is very far from our tradition. But I think the background for that is this emphasis that the Lutherans have of wanting to stress the humanity of Jesus and to see these, well, their other thing is sola scriptura and reading the Bible very literally and saying there's actually nothing there that explicitly tells us this was a virgin birth. We just know that Mary, the Mother of God, was a virgin when Gabriel came to her. Then the Catholics sometimes are very technical about it and talk about three stages. in partum, postpartum, and so forth, which I think from the Orthodox perspective is often seen as far too technical. This is a mystery. It's not something we should really go into. But the important thing to realize is that this mysterious birth is a sign of Christ's divinity. And the fathers do make much of that. And so it's in association with the incarnation and what we do understand about the mystery of the incarnation that we know we must maintain that Mary is truly human. Otherwise, Christ could not have taken his physical nature from her. But that he is also the Word of God. He is, there's not a kind of break in history where he suddenly becomes something else in his incarnation. He remains what he always was, which was the Logos. And this birth is a sign of that. It reveals that to us. And the Mother of God, with regard to, if we are going to take it apart and talk about postpartum, which is another issue of controversy, whether she ever had children afterwards or had sexual relations, I think it's an association with our veneration of the Mother of God, with her holiness, with her, what we know of her contemplative life and her dedication to God, that we just don't think it's really possible. She took on the life of a mother or had more children. But of course, scripture doesn't tell us explicitly about this, but certainly church tradition does. And what is developed in later texts is that she was always with Christ, and then she went to live with the beloved disciple after his death, was cared for by him, and was living possibly with a community of women, but we know very little. St. John Chrysostom, who interprets it in this way. The passage is in Judges. Judges chapter 6, verses 36 following. So I'll read it aloud. This is the story of Gideon, who has been told to wage war against the Midianites, and he asks God for a sign. He doesn't really want to enter into this unless he's sure he's going to win this battle. So he asks for a sign from God. So Gideon said to God, "If you save Israel by my hand, as you said, then look, I shall put a fleece of wool on the threshing floor. If there is dew on the fleece only, and it is dry on all the ground, then I shall know that you will save Israel by my hand, as you said." So, and he rose early the next morning and wrung the fleece, and from the fleece dropped enough dew to fill a pan full of water. But Gideon wasn't quite persuaded by this miracle. He said to God, "Indeed, I pray, do not let your anger be aroused at me, and I will speak but once. I will yet make one more trial with the fleece. This time, let it be dry on the fleece, but let there be dew all over the ground." And that night God made it so. On the fleece it was completely dry, but there was dew all over the ground. Now, how do we arrive at the view or the intuition that this fleece represents, prefigures the Mother of God? In a canon for the Nativity of the Mother of God, we read, "You alone, O sheep without blemish, from your womb have offered to Christ, the Lamb of God, our substance to be his fleece. Therefore, in our hymns, we honor you on this day of your Nativity," from Anna. I'm not sure if I have some other examples that are more explicit. "Let us all magnify the radiant cloud in which the Master of all descended, as dew from heaven upon the fleece, and for our sake took flesh and was made man. What St. John Chrysostom did in interpreting this passage to understand that the Mother of God is a antitype, if you like, a sign of this fleece, is to say that this fleece, which is a material object again, and here again we see the stress on the real physical nature, this created aspect of the Mother of God. She is the fleece. The dew is, of course, the incarnation, the divine person entering, being present in this fleece. So again, it's an image of heaven joining earth, of some kind of sign of them coming together into one place. But the other thing that St. John Chrysostom says in his exegesis of this passage in Judges is what we see shown in this story is the mysterious, silent, and humble way in which God came into creation in the incarnation. That he didn't come riding a chariot with trumpets blowing or at the head of an army. This sign, this type, indicates the silence, the humility, the way in which he entered creation in a way in which no one could recognize. I find that fascinating, that he would interpret the text in this way and see it as a sign of the incarnation, which indicates the quietness of the incarnation, if you like. But again, as I say, I think what the type represents inherently, of course, is the way in which material creation can become imbued, impregnated, full, like the burning bush, with divine presence. And that's what that type is supposed to convey to us. Any thoughts, reactions, or shall I go straight on? Have any of you wondered when you came across the Mother of God being addressed as Gideon's fleece? What is meant by that? Yes. But you've looked it up and understood, I dare say. I think one of the purposes of such typology and why we see it repeated in services so much in our communal prayer is that it helps us to reflect, to pray, to meditate on the mystery. It's not telling us everything openly, explicitly, discursively. It's telling us the mystery through this very symbolic language, if you like, of imagery. And finally, my last example is another wonderful form of typology, which is that of the mountain. We frequently find in liturgical services the Mother of God being addressed as or described as a holy mountain. And if you look carefully at things which describe her as the mountain, you will see that they may refer to various different passages in the Old Testament. There are a number of mountain types, and sometimes the hymn itself will reveal which it is. It's never made explicit. We think of many mountains, as I've already said. There's Sinai, and some types may in fact refer to Sinai, where God revealed himself to Moses and gave him the tablets of the law. Some types do refer to that, I think. But there are other, perhaps more mysterious references where we hear of a mountain that is forested, that is shady. We don't think particularly of Sinai being a shady mountain, do we? I think when it's mentioned as a shady mountain, this is often a reference to Habakkuk, where we do hear of wooded mountains. And in that particular passage, we are told of a cloud, a stormy cloud that appears on this mountain. The cloud is understood to be Christ, to be God, appearing in creation, the mountain is understood to refer to the Mother of God. Through that, she is the place where he appeared, or where he manifested himself. So here are two hymns which I think refer to Habakkuk. O Christ, you have sprung from a virgin. From the mountain overshadowed by the forest you have come, made flesh from her that knew not wedlock. Or again, the overshadowed mountain that Habakkuk foresaw and announced prophetically in days of old has come to dwell within the sanctuary of the temple. There she has put forth flowers of virtue, and with her shadow she covers the ends of the earth. So this is a hymn for the entry of the Mother of God into the temple, but referring to her to her as a mountain where God appeared. There are other examples too, though, which seem to refer to other mountains. This is a classic one, very interesting one, which is the reference of the mountain of God as a fertile mountain. A mountain, I'm sorry about the typographical errors, this was written up rather hastily, richly curdled with milk, a fat mountain. If you look at the Psalm, Psalm 67, verse 16, we find in the Septuagint this phrase, oros pion, oros heteromenon, oros pion, a rich mountain, a mountain literally made into cheese, a rich mountain. Very mysterious. It's the Septuagint translation of the Hebrew, of course. But what does it mean? And why do we see a type of the Mother of God here? Father Ephraim, again, has suggested an answer to that question. He suggests, and I think he refers to the Hebrew as well here, that this idea of a curdled mountain is actually referring to the process of gestation. There was an ancient belief that in the womb, an embryo was actually slightly curdled by the blood of the mother and begins to be nourished and to grow and to develop as a sort of process of curdling in the womb. You may or may not accept that explanation, or believe that that is what the fathers are seeing here. But what we can say for sure is that they are referring to the Mother of God when they address her as the mountain most rich, the mountain who is curdled, as we see in the canon for Tuesday, the second week in Lent, Ode 9. So that's a reference to the Psalm. Sometimes, as I've said, we see a reference to Habakkuk, sometimes to Sinai. There's also, of course, one other. Can anyone think of another reference to a mountain that is a type of the Mother of God? I'm going to throw this one out to you. Yes.
Well, I think of Daniel.
Yes.
Yes.
The uncut mountain from which the rock that is Christ is taken, which is in the book of Daniel, yes. And that's another very common type that we see. So with regard to the mountain, when you encounter it in iconography, if you're disposed to reflect and think about these images, I think it's important to think, where is this referring to in the Old Testament? What is it meaning? It's possible with typology that sometimes you have many meanings rolled into one, that the hymnographer wants us to think of all the mountains at once. I wouldn't rule that out. Because I do think the fathers, the hymnographers, layer things. They never rule out any given meaning. They never forget the literal meaning of these texts. But they see many, many other meanings coming in too. And they're not afraid of having many at once. But it is, forgive me for adding this gloss, but it is a strange image, is it not? Think of the Mother of God as a mountain? Does anyone else react in that way? I see you nodding your heads. Why do you think we refer to her in this way? Why do we see the Mother of God embodied in the mountains of the Old Testament? What is the theological meaning of that? I would just like you to be free in your interpretations and to give me some ideas. The fact that they reach heaven, that they are holy places. As you ascend a mountain, you get to thinner air, don't you? And it's often a place where people ascend to have some kind of revelation. If any of you have been lucky enough to climb Mount Sinai, which I have, you do have a very special feeling on the top of that mountain. You see very far from the top of a mountain. You feel the air is thin, you feel close to God. You feel also there have been many holy people there before you. On Sinai in particular, there's often been a holy man up there in residence, right back to the 4th century. We know that people had their hermitages up there and welcomed the pilgrimages, the pilgrims who climbed up. What else about mountains, though? I have many other associations in my mind.
It's sort of the place where God promises things as well. You know, it's the law given on Sinai and Ararat, where the ark comes to rest, where the new covenant is made. And,
mm-hmm.
And then obviously New Testament as well. But so it's a place where there's really significant dogma coming, I suppose.
Yes, so God makes his will known on a mountain. He manifests himself. I mean, the most significant event in the New Testament is the Transfiguration on Mount Tabor. Why did Christ choose to go up a mountain to reveal himself as God to the 3 disciples? Are there any other thoughts about mountains?
Yes, this is not directly, unless something helps to find the Mother of God in this. When briefly this morning meditation was mentioned, I remember being given, and I wish I could remember the name of the 5th century, I think, writer, who says, when you meditate, be like a mountain, and then says one or two other things about that. And then the next verse, when you meditate, be as a river, and some things about that. And so there are 5 images that he draws out for aiding you in your meditation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a rather lateral thinking, but I like it, because to meditate on the Mother of God, what better?
Yes. I must say, did you want to say
something? Oh, I was just thinking, just a thought that came to me, but there's a verse in the Bible that says, the Mother of God, she held all these things in her heart, I haven't said it correctly, but it's something like this. And something about the serenity of the Mother of God. She's kind of contains the whole world, like in her prayers. And when we like kind of look at a mountain, that sort of a mountain has that, it kind of conveys that to us. It's like strong but calm, and it doesn't move. Like the song, they talk about the mountains, they don't move. You know, from the beginning of time, and yeah, I don't know, this serenity that mountain kind of evokes something about that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. I mean, I don't know how much Orthodox tradition wants us to freely associate. I have real questions in my own mind about this, but to me as well, it conveys this sense of serenity, of solidity. It's an image of creation, which brings across very clearly, I think, the Mother of God as truly a physical person who is rooted in the universe, in the earth. So it's a very earthy image, a very stable image, and the immensity of it too. I agree with all of those things. Perhaps we enter the realm of metaphor more than typology when we go on to these sort of associations. But I can't believe they're not to some extent intended by the teachers of the church, the hymnographers.
May I ask for a comment from you or from anybody? When it, in, it says mountain, in brackets, heal the passions of our souls. Someone was just speaking this morning about passions. I'm asking, what, you know, how is the mountain to heal the passions of our souls? I miss a connection there.
Yes, I think this must be a typographical error. I'm not sure the parenthesis is meant to be there, the bracket.
Well, whether or not.
Or what
my
punctuation there was, and I don't have the text with me. Do you remember Metropolitan Calistos? Because you translated this.
I didn't translate that.
Oh, no, that's our plan. Oh, I think I have the article somewhere. I'll look it up later. I don't want to take time.
Yeah.
Well, I could if people want me to. I'll have to dig around in my bag. I'll do it later. I'm not sure how that text fits together. So I'm sorry, I'll have to leave that.
It's the great thing about passions, you see.
Yes.
Healing, transforming, destroying.
Yes.
So, just a thought on this, maybe quite a naive thought, just immediately the idea that pops into mind. Ascending mountains has always been associated with asceticism. That's obviously, that's the case of many mountains.
Yes.
And this, actually, this bit of another? Of course, that's the question, asceticism as part of healing. But is that one of the mountains that is explicitly associated with asceticism that has not been mentioned is Mount Carmel. Can you tell us, maybe are there any typologies between Mount Carmel and Mount God? It's not a question.
Can you remind me of Mount Carmel and where that occurs?
Well, it's related, of course, to the prophet Elijah.
Oh, yes.
That's where he dwelt.
Yes,
it's
of course, yes.
Kingdoms?
The kingdoms, it would be, yes. I don't recall that being a type or being referred to, but it may well be. As I say, these hymns don't give us footnotes.
Yes.
It's up to us, really, to discover
where
the fathers and where the hymnographers are taking these types from. But it's very much a part of tradition, so much a part that, you know, we begin to know where they come from. But what I have been struck by is the fact that there's no explanation in the hymnography. The hymnographers don't take the time to say, by this we mean such and such and such and such. It's just cited, and we are supposed to know what this refers to. So it's part of our education as Christians, I think, to read the Old Testament, reflect upon it, and to begin to understand the typology that's used in the hymnography. So you may well find Mount Carmel does appear. I'm not sure I have the answer today. John. Just keep an eye on the time.
You said that that is perhaps metaphor rather than typology.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is what's troubling me at the back of my mind as well. I can appreciate all these references as imaginative images, ideas that one might enjoy, develop, find fruitful, have pleasure in, as one might do with any poetic image. And in a way, I think what you've been doing is, in a way, like an English literature lecture explaining poetry. This is what the poet had in mind, these are his associations, these are the, this is to help you to have the same associations and develop them in the same sort of way. What is troubling me, I think, is that typology seems to be more than that. It's almost perhaps an element of prophecy to it, perhaps even a bit like a crossword puzzle, or a clue to a crossword puzzle, that it's got some meaning itself. Very often, if the sentence makes sense, the clue makes sense, but you're not seeing it in the right way at all. And once you have seen it in the right way, it's probably self-authenticating. Yes, that's the answer. It's got all the right characteristics. It fits the clue perfectly. It fits in the space. And what seems to be being the impression I get is in typology, it's that these statements were placed in the Old Testament for us to discover. And it's almost that they are certainly at least as important, if not more important, than the straight text as perhaps, say, Jewish reader might read it nowadays. And yet, I mean, if that is so, I think the questions that I come to mind are, well, first of all, why was the development of typology so late? And from an early time, people were expected to study the Old Testament scriptures and see them as prophecies of Christ. Were they being, when we read that people were told to do that, were they being expected to see these types? Is that what they were being expected to find and see these as evidence for the Christian proclamation? In which case, are these texts simply something that existed for several hundred years in Christian tradition before they were written down? And I suppose associated with this, how does one recognize, if one is reading the Old Testament, how does one recognize that this is actually a type that one needs to interpret? Have there been lots of them missed, which no one has realized that these are types and which one should be learning to understand and expand?
I think that we have to remember that the Old Testament, as we call it, was Christian scripture from the very beginning, when Jesus and his followers were reading the Torah, the Old Testament, and as people were writing about him, the evangelist, towards the end of the first century, they understood the Old Testament to be primarily about Christ, that it is the story that is leading up to Christ and that is prophetically revealing Christ in numerous ways. You have straight prophecies, but you also have these, I think you put it beautifully, these things are there as types. They're not something we're imposing on the Old Testament. But if we have the eyes to see them, which Christians do, we can see that they are revealing Christ. Now the question is, well, just to develop that a bit further, we see it in the very texts that were written about Christ. If you look at Luke, the way he describes the Annunciation and the birth of Christ, he is using typology. He speaks of the power of the Most High overshadowing, referring back to those passages in the Old Testament where God made himself manifest in the tabernacle. You already see that typology. But it refers, in the beginning, in the earliest Christian centuries, to Christ primarily, the this typological reading, this prophetic indication in everything as a sign of what would happen in the new dispensation and in the incarnation. The puzzle is why people began to associate it with Mary, the mother of God, only slightly later. We really only see it beginning in the 4th century that people see her in these types, and that they associate her specifically with types like the burning bush. I don't really have an answer to that question. It's just a kind of piece of literary analysis. That's not what we should be doing when we're looking at typology. I was trying to unpack, if you like, the kind of theological teaching, but as you say, the signs are there. It's not something any writer is imposing on the Old Testament. It's something that's being discerned. And it is a process that happens slowly in the tradition as the fathers begin to reflect more and to make this more explicit.
To me, the important meaning of typology is unity, the unity of Holy Scripture and the unity of sacred history, that everything is connected with everything else. And that is the way the fathers interpret Scripture. You understand one passage by bringing into comparison a whole series of other passages. When I was being taught history at school, our history master had a favorite phrase, it all ties up, you see, it all ties up. And that, I think, is the way the fathers read Scripture. And therefore they saw Scripture as a unity to every other part, instead of as the scholars adopt today. And then again, the unity of sacred history, that you are not to just see it as a series of disconnected events, but all bound up together. Everything in sacred history, everything in the Old Testament, points forward to the incarnation of Christ, which is the center of all history. So I think, to me, this is what's behind typology. It enables you to see the Bible as a whole and to see sacred history as a whole. And of course typology, perhaps you said this last night and I may have missed it, is already present in the New Testament, likens the crossing of the Red Sea to baptism. Crossing of the Red Sea is seen as a type of baptism. What I suppose we are concerned about is there a real connection, or is it a purely arbitrary comparison? In the case of the crossing of the Red Sea, the deliverance of the people of Israel from Egypt, there's a clear parallel with baptism, which brings the deliverance from sin, and water plays a part in both of them. But sometimes the analogies seem to us today to be very forced. So perhaps there are variations in typology. I'm not sure whether there is a clear differentiation between typology and metaphor. It seems to me they overlap, and a lot of typology could be seen as metaphor. Again, modern writers distinguish typology from allegory, but the fathers don't. And the word allegory comes in the New Testament and is used by Paul. But the primary thing surely about typology is that we are to see.
And the words for signs, in Greek and in Latin, simeon and signum, suffer a semantical mutation. My area of research is semiotics, so I deal with this quite a bit. Everybody in semiotics knows that semiotics, as we know it today, comes directly from Augustine's De Doctrina Christiana, where he defines sign, he gives an example, and the reason for which Augustine does that in the Doctrina Christiana is explicitly and specifically to offer hermeneutical tools to Christians in their reading of the Bible. The semantic limitation that these terms suffer at that point is from understanding the concept of sign either as a natural phenomenon. I see clouds, therefore it's going to rain. Clouds, there's a relation of signification between clouds and rain. Or as it was used also in classical Greek philosophy, like Simeon as middle term of an argument, of a syllogism. I think, yeah, absolutely. I'll try to make myself clear, sorry. It's a quite curious thing for me that there's a lot of quite rich research coming from semiotics into this, but theology has so far not looked much into that. I'm still strictly speaking of theological academic studies. Did not look perhaps yet thoroughly in the relevance of this event in the history of ideas. Because as it was not suggested earlier, how would a contemporary Jew person read these passages which in our minds immediately evoke these typological relations? And obviously, Augustine, because I mentioned Augustine, he is recognized by semioticians as perhaps the father of semiotics, as we know it today. But the concept of sign, or concept, perhaps different words used in the same way, are very abundant in the Church Fathers, in Fathers before Augustine. Ambrose of Milano, who influenced Augustine a lot, has such examples. Not to mention the Areopagite writings, whenever they are dated. In the Areopagite writings, we don't encounter much the term Simeon, perhaps at all, but he prefers the term image, at least. Yes. But it is used exactly as the concept of sign has been widely used in semiotics. And as Metropolitan Callistus, His Eminence, said, in that hermeneutical school, there is no difference. There is not much difference between allegories and metaphor. This is, I think, something that contemporary semiotics picks up quite interestingly. And we see it still in patristics, but later, very clearly, in John of Damascus, which makes the point that symbolic signification has to be embedded, grounded on iconic signification. This is his philosophical argument for the veneration of icons. I'm sorry for talking too much, I don't know how much light I should shed it, but something that is interesting to me, and I think might be interesting in the context of the apostolic method of allegoresis.
It is very interesting, thank you. One thing I think it's worth bearing in mind, which I think relates to typology and types, is that for the Greek patristic mind, the concept of image is a very strong thing. In fact, some fathers, I think Gregory of Nazianzus uses the words charakter, which really means an imprint, and icon, an image, almost interchangeably. An image really, for the fathers, has something of the prototype in it, in a much stronger sense than perhaps we think of an image. And this is embraced and taken into Orthodox Christian tradition, really thanks to St. John of Damascus. I think he spells it all out. And he also lists all the different kinds of images, and he does seem to sort of rank them hierarchically almost, with Christ as the image of God the Father being at the very top. So typology is in that list. He talks about types and prefigurations, and he talks about them, as I remember, before he talks about man-made icons or images. So for him, they are something that conveys truth, that is related to the thing that they are depicting. So the burning bush image, as reflected in the Mother of God, the two are closely connected in some way, not ontologically, if you want to get into sort of philosophical language, but it's a much stronger connection than something that's just reflecting. Just another thought I have on that topic. I was working with a Syrian monk for a while on a thesis that he's writing on St. Ephraim. And he was always telling me about this word in Syriac, raza, which means sign, and implying or telling me that it's a word like icon, but St. Ephraim uses it in a much stronger way. It's this physical way in which God manifests himself, whether it's a sacrament, in the mirror of the scriptures. He often uses the image of scripture being a mirror. But God is somehow imprinted and makes himself known through these razai, I think that's the plural of the word. And it's a much stronger connecting thing, perhaps even than the Greek concept of icon. So I think possibly different cultures, different traditions have different ideas about what the connection between something and something that is describing it is. So I think it's a very interesting topic.
Of course, it has to be remembered that the Greek icon, image, has a much stronger sense. It has to be remembered that the Greek icon or image has a much stronger sense than our word image. The basic point about an icon is it establishes a real connection. An icon is not just a picture that acts as a visual aid or a reminder. An icon brings you into contact with that which it depicts. Through the icon of Christ, we enter into communion with Christ himself. The icon is a point of encounter and meeting, so that behind the idea of the icon is sharing, participation. So in that way, I think the icon has quite a strong sense of bringing together two different realities. I wanted to ask another question, which relates to right at the beginning of what you were saying this afternoon. We say to the Mother of God, Most Holy Mother of God, save us. And in one of the texts that occurs very often, it is said to Mary, you are the salvation of the Christian race. Now, we do not usually say to the other saints, save us. We say to them, pray for us. And in the case of the Holy Virgin, is there not something paradoxical here? Is not Christ the only Savior? The Protestants, when they hear us saying to the Mother of God, save us, are scandalized. And after all, in the Magnificat, Mary herself refers to Christ as her Savior, God as her Savior. My spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. So Mary is saved by Christ, just as we are. How then can it be that we say to Mary, save us? How do you explain that?
I think that is difficult. I can only understand the word, the verb to save in that context being in a rather general sense, it does not mean, I'm sure, technically, she is going to be there at the Last Judgment, deciding whether we are saved or damned. Only the righteous judge, Christ, can do that. But it's said in the sense, I think, of we are all swimming in this sea of passions. We are struggling. We look for help, not only to Christ, but to the Mother of God and to the saints. And we call out to her and say, save me from this sea of passions. Grab my hand. Help me. That's the way I would understand that prayer being meant, but not in a sort of truly soteriological sense that she can save us, because she saves us by her intercession with Christ and by being close to him and knowing him in all his glory. And at the same time, as Father Melchizedek was saying, she loves us all so much. She cares. She is praying on our behalf and saving us in that way. And that's what we always have to keep in mind. What do you mean?
I just wanted to add to this very question which Bishop Callistos has brought. I remember 30 years ago, thank you, Metropolitan Anthony was speaking in a church in Kensington, not his own cathedral, and I can't remember if it was a Protestant church, but I asked him, because he'd been saying, Mother of God, save us, and I was very new to Orthodoxy and very enthusiastic, but suddenly something in me revolted, and I stood up and I said, Bishop Anthony, my Protestant soul has just jumped up and said, how can she save us when there's only one Saviour? So I'm trying to remember his exact answer, but what I do remember is an aspect which has always stayed with me. He said, sometimes to watch a person to whom you are very close suffering is more of an agony than the person who is in the middle of that suffering. I think I see what he means and can agree. You know, you love that person so much, but you are helpless, you can't do anything. And so this is the great grief that she had, that pain that pierced her heart. And it was that aspect that he said we tap into when we're in agony and say, save us. She is watching her son suffer,
yes.
And she's in agony.
Thank you for that, yes. I don't think there will be time now today to go into the icons I was going to talk about, but one of the things we've already touched on it with Father Melchizedek's talk. When he spoke of this in the face of the Mother of God on many icons, this very sad expression, this pain, as you say, the suffering, she takes into herself God's self-emptying, that kenosis, and she feels it, she suffers it, and expresses it for the rest of us in a way, I think. And in that sense, she stands for all of us, but she also bears our pain for all of us. She knows from the very beginning, in all the icons of the Nativity, you can see her foreseeing the passion. It's so striking that she is not looking overjoyed as someone who's just given birth to the Son of God. She's looking sad. She's often looking away from the Christ child. Another aspect of that gaze, and I do have an icon so we can be looking at this. She's often looking towards Joseph, who is this figure in the bottom left-hand corner of the icon, who often looks very troubled, if not seriously upset. Some people say that in some icons, it's the devil who's speaking to him on his right. Because he had doubts, he had fears. And Mary, the Mother of God, is not looking at her child. She's looking at Joseph with complete compassion. She knows what he's feeling. She knows he's in a state of doubt. He's not really with her in this scene. where you would want your husband or your betrothed to be. But she forgives him. She's completely forgiving and also foreseeing that she somehow embodies humanity's recognition of what this incarnation means, where it's leading, the pain that will be involved, the complete sacrifice that Christ is experiencing both in the incarnation and in the crucifixion, and she takes it all into herself. And in that sense, she goes with us in that pain and saves us in that pain.
Oh, surely the sufferings of Christ are complete, and how could there be anything lacking in them, and how could we add anything to them? But what St. Paul is saying is that we are called to be co-sufferers, to suffer with Christ, and that in suffering with and for Christ, we are contributing to the salvation of the world. Then, what you have said, what Pope was saying, surely applies here to the Mother of God, that she, more than anyone, suffered with Christ in his suffering. She, more than anyone, was a co-suffering, a sufferer. And she, more than anyone, has fulfilled what St. Paul asks us to do, to make up what is lacking in the sufferings of Christ, to be with Christ and under him, co-redeemers. So I don't have any objection to the title that some Roman Catholics apply to Mary, where they call her co-redemptrix, because I think, yes, we are all called to be co-redeemers with Christ, to join with him in his suffering for the salvation of the world, and she does so to an exceptional degree.
I had a whole section on icons, but I don't think there's time to embark on it. But we've covered a lot of extremely interesting ground, and I'm very grateful for all of your contributions. They're extremely helpful because I'm trying to wrestle with these questions myself, as you may have noticed, and think about them. And everything you've said has been extremely helpful.